Okay, good afternoon. My name is Paul Radensky. I'm the Senior Director for Education here at the Museum of Jewish Heritage, a living memorial to the Holocaust. I am pleased to welcome all of you this afternoon. Our program is entitled German Jewry Under the Nazis. The many crimes of the Nazis, the unleashing of World War II, the destruction of much of Europe, and the mass murder of 6 million Jews and millions of others overshadowed their earlier crimes. Nevertheless, the earlier crimes, among others, the persecution of German Jews, are significant as well. The steps the Nazis took to persecute German Jewry is an important topic. Perhaps even more important, however, at least for our purposes, is how German Jews responded to the oppression. Those of you who have been to the Museum of Jewish Heritage and have seen our old core exhibition know that presenting the Jewish side of the experience of the Holocaust is an important but underrepresented part of Holocaust education. We are fortunate that Professor Natalia Aleksiun will teach us today about German Jewry under the Nazis, and will share insights and experiences and feelings of the German Jews themselves. I would like to add that it is particularly appropriate that Professor Aleksiun is speaking on German Jewry today, since she is speaking to us from the university city of Vienna, near Weimar and Erfurt, and not far from Leipzig in eastern Germany. Let me tell you a little bit more about Professor Aleksiun. She is professor of modern Jewish history at the Graduate School of Touro College. She is an historian of Eastern European Jewish history and the Holocaust. She published, and among her books are Where to the Zionist Movement in Poland, 1944 to 1950, and she co-edited the 20th and 29th volumes of Pauline. Her critical edition of Gershon Taffet's The Destruction of Zhilkiv Jews was published in 2019. Her book titled Conscious History, Polish Jewish Historians Before the Holocaust will be published by the Litman Library in 2020. She is currently working on a book about the so-called cadaver affair at European universities in the 1920s and 1930s, and on a project dealing with the daily lives of Jews hiding in Galicia during the Holocaust. Let me also add that I've had the good fortune to know Professor Aleksiun since my graduate student days, and she has taught here at the museum now for many years. On behalf of myself and the educators who have attended our professional development programs and our stage seminars, we look forward to learning with Professor Aleksiun today and for many years to come. And we are honored that Professor Aleksiun is joining us this afternoon. Before I turn the floor over to Professor Aleksiun, I just would like to do a quick plug for some of our upcoming programs. Tomorrow evening, November 16th, Wendy Lauer will present The Ravine, a family, a photograph, and a Holocaust massacre revealed. And if you would like to register, the registration is still open for that program. On Monday, December 7th, Avi Pott will present The Jewish Heroes of Warsaw, The Afterlife of the Revolt. And that's about how the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising was understood and presented after the war. On Tuesday, December 15th, Professor Rebecca Coburn will explore the United States Refugee Policy and Anti-Semitism, 1924 to 1954. Our plan for today is as follows. Professor Aleksiun will speak for approximately 45 minutes, after which we will invite questions from the teachers attending the program. We will try to keep the program an hour in length. We will be accepting questions via chat. Okay, after the lecture, we will send you a link to an online evaluation form. Please plan to spend a few minutes completing it. Your feedback is important to us and to our funder, the Claims Conference, and I appreciate your taking this task seriously. I would like to take a moment to thank a number of people. First of all, my colleague, Joanna Arruda, who is working with us on this program today, and of course, Professor Aleksiun and my colleagues in the Education Department. I'd also like to take a moment to thank the Claims Conference, or rather the Conference on Jewish Material Claims Against Germany, for funding today's program. And now, without further ado, I'm pleased to present Professor Natalia Aleksiun.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Paul. And it is my honor to be here with you today listening to what's in store in the coming weeks and months. I'm truly in a wonderful company. So thank you for this. I want to talk today about German Jewish experience and focus, like Paul suggested, not so much on the part that pertains to the destruction in 1942, 43, 44, but rather focus on the early years and with an eye on presenting this extremely complex and overlooked time, also think about what might be useful and productive ways of presenting this material to students. Let me share with you the PowerPoint, which will also help me not to go over time. When we talk about German Jewish experience, it's of course a very complex notion, but I want to start with numbers. As a historian that focuses on Eastern European Jewish experience and especially Polish Jewish history, when you look at the numbers on this map showing the largest Jewish communities on the eve of Hitler's rise to power, the difference, a numerical difference, is striking. The largest community, Berlin, is 160,000 Jews, but some other larger communities are already 20, 26, and under 20,000. Just for comparison, Warsaw is 300,000, Lviv, Lemberg, is approaching 70,000. So again, this is a community that is very, very important for Jewish history in Europe, but is not numerically the center of Jewish life on the eve of the Holocaust. Some of the information about it. So we are talking about 500,000 of Jews, and they constitute less than 1% of German population with these urban centers. And in general, this is a highly urbanized, highly educated, middle class, upper middle class community. Of course, there are Jews who live in smaller towns and villages. There are Jews such as families that live in Bavaria, who are cattle dealers, who are in those trading professions in the context of agriculture. However, the majority, the vast majority of German Jews are urban, middle class, upper middle class, and educated, or at least beyond the primary school education. They are also, as you could see, not spread evenly throughout the country. One of the largest communities is Breslau, today Wrocław in Poland. And you can see just examples of the institutions that the community took great pride in, the Jewish Theological Seminary that is now a parking lot, and the new synagogue, which is to be burned, was going to be burned on Kristallnacht, the second largest synagogue in Germany after Berlin. This is a community that seemingly is a story of great success, of cultural integration. For me, a truly compelling example is this chief cantor of the new synagogue in Breslau, who is doubling as a singer in the opera, in a local opera in Breslau. You see here an old postcard of the building that still stands and serves as an opera. This is a community that at least on the surface is also extremely successful, many very visible businesses are Jewish businesses, and what can be more visible than beautiful, illustrious, elaborate department store such as this one in Breslau. But German Jewry, on the eve of the of Hitler's rise to power, is also Eastern European Jews, so-called Ostjuden, who tend to, at least the first generation, to be a little more traditional, Yiddish speaking, and less affluent. Of course, this is a great generalization. So it is a community that, if you look deeper, is much more complex and much more diverse than this official site of highly educated, highly successful professionals and business people. And just as an example, this is one of the paintings that was painted in Berlin by a Ukrainian Jewish refugee, painter, illustrator, stage designer, who spent several years in Berlin after he escaped from Ukraine. And painted a lot of those images of pogroms and anti-Semitic violence. So when we associate Berlin with the rise of Hitler, with swastika, Berlin until that point is also a very, very important center of publishing, of Jewish literature, scholarship, visual arts, etc., etc. There are numerous organizations that serve a Jewish community, of women, of veterans, Jewish, more traditional, and those that, as you can see here, Union of German Citizens of the Jewish Faith. This tells you something about this, the way in which this organization was presenting the identity of its members, first as German citizens, and then their Jewishness was only a matter of religion, not a matter of national identity. And in general, German Jewry is extremely proud of its status in the Weimar Republic, a community that has enjoyed the fruits of emancipation for several decades. I don't want to spend too much time today speaking about the Nazis, because this is in a way a parallel story to the story of the German Jewry up to 1933. But just to give you a taste of when all these Jewish physicians, lawyers, professors, authors, artists, but also traders and shopkeepers are active, the Nazi movement has from the very beginning very explicitly an anti-Semitic message and very explicitly racist message. You see here just an example from one of the earliest speeches made by Hitler already in 1920, and that message then continues throughout his Mein Kampf. Here is a one of the many examples in which he rants against Jews as enemies of Germany and enemies of humanity, really, seeking to take over power destroying political stability, economic stability, and destroying culture. And again, just to give you a sense of a kind of visual message that accompanies the continued mobilization through Nazi posters, but this is only one aspect of the propaganda, but these are posters that you would see on the streets of German towns. They play with Christian motifs. Here you have a saint slaughtering a dragon, and the dragon has a stereotypically anti-Semitic features of its head. And in case you didn't notice, the dragon has a little Star of David, so that it's absolutely clear who is being slaughtered by a Christian saint who is also embracing this handsome Nazi fighter. And again, Jews associated with snakes, with all the evils of the society, economic difficulties, cultural degeneration. And on the other hand, what is being offered is this national unity, strength, and self-defense. And the language of self-defense, as it were, is often precisely presented in this propaganda. So when we start the story in 1933, that discourse of demonization of Jews as enemies of Germany, attacking and threatening the very fabric of German nation, Volk, which has this biological, racial, racist rather aspect to it, has been already going on for a while. And now I very much like the idea that Raoul Hilberg put together with the step-by-step destruction, in which we can distinguish stages that lead to the last stage, annihilation. But of course we need to remember, when we think about what German Jews thought and felt and how they responded, that they were only in the moment, that they had the knowledge and the understanding based on the reality, the context, the facts that were available to them at the time, and that we have the hindsight that they obviously lacked, just like in any other historical processes that we can only see and make sense of fully when they're over. So in the early months, weeks and months after Hitler becomes the chancellor of Germany, and in the last elections before he does not win the majority, but because of political maneuvers, he is nominated, he's appointed to be the chancellor. What really Jews can make of it is obviously a sense of threat, a sense of great danger, but likely more what I put here, undermining the some in some ways viability of Jewish presence in Germany, possibly undermining emancipation, but obviously none of the things that will come later. And in fact, the early stages of the assault, of the attack, are actually directed, despite Hitler's speeches, despite the propaganda, are actually directed against political enemies, especially socialists and communists. So I want to now show you a few of the personal perspectives on what's going on. What do Jews see when they look around in those crucial, transformative early weeks and months? One of the most amazing diaries written at the time is the diary of Viktor Kremperer. If you haven't had a chance to read, I highly recommend. There is edition in one volume, there are larger editions. He is a professor of French literature with a keen interest in linguistics. And in fact, he is going to author one of the most important analyses of the Nazi language, Lingua Terti Imperi. But Klemperer is in a way, a marginal Jew. He is born to a traditional family, rabbinical family, but he converts to Protestantism, as you see here on the slide. He marries a Protestant wife, a woman whose family is not thrilled, neither is his, but this is Weimar Republic, and such unions are not uncommon. He's a patriotic German, and in fact, he converts not so much out of religious conviction, but this is his statement of loyalty to Germany as a German. And he's teaching at the university in Dresden, not far away from where I am right now. So when he writes in January 14th, this is a 2 weeks before Hitler becomes the chancellor, this is a diary of a professor, you know, with all kinds of department matter, problems, issues. He and his wife are planning to build a little house outside. There is no real sense of something imminent, of some terrible danger that is around. And of course, this is following months and months of very, very radicalized political campaign. And then if we had more time, we would look at more closely. But when he writes already after Hitler's nomination, and then skips to the elections, and what he describes is a sense of terrible terror. And this is some element that we will find in all personal accounts from those early weeks and months, a sense of growing pressure, a sense of growing threat, that people are increasingly afraid. Nothing happened yet. The concentration camp in Dachau is only open in March. So this is just the beginning, but the sense of threat is very clear, and it happened over a short period of time. Indeed, we have here what Klemperer is referring to, the provocation with the fire of Reichstag, German seat of parliament, of which the communists are accused by the Nazis, and it allows them to suspend many of the civil rights and protections, followed by elections that Klemperer mentions on the previous page, elections in which SA and SS brown shirts were marching around, intimidating voters. And yet, with all this intimidation, in the last elections before the end of the war, where there are not only the Nazi party, but also other parties, well, we can say only or as many as 43.9 votes were cast for the Nazis. And then what follows is basically legal act that gives Hitler full power with no need to pass his decisions through Reichstag, through the parliament. And that is something that becomes again very clear as a game changer, this moment of elections and the fear that descends on people, not just again on Jews, but also anybody that is not aligned with Nazis politically. And he sums it up here, a complete revolution and party dictatorship. He recognizes the change that is happening in Germany. I think I'm moving in the wrong direction. Yes, this is President von Hindenburg, who signed those special powers given to Hitler. Here you have one of the voting ballots. This one is from Berlin, and you see that the Nazi party is first and the opposition is at the very bottom of the ballot. The scenes from days leading up to the election and the day of voting, and this unification of power, which is also unification under the calls for Germany belonging to Volk, to nation that is defined in racial terms. So one's patriotic feelings, one's service to Germany, familiarity with history, language, culture, contribution, none of it matters as long as you are not a member of the folk. And you see very clearly in Klemperer's diary how people are reading the signs, are reading what's happening. Just one note here, already on March 22, their friends have a non-Jewish servant, and she realizes that her Jewish employers will not be able to pay her. They are becoming basically risky people to work for, and she hands in the notice. And there is more and more of those signs. Klemperer describes here scenes from schools where students are blasting into singing informal Nazi anthem, Horst Wessel song. You can briefly look here at the English translation. It's ascribed to Horst Wessel, who died of his wounds after being wounded by communist members of the Communist Party in Berlin, and he became a Nazi martyr. So that element of fear, of terror, but also of euphoria is entering all those spaces, both private and public. Just a look at the child's perspective. Here you have a perspective of a Berlin girl, Inge Deutschkron, who only in 1933 finds out she's Jewish. Her parents simply realize that she needs to be told. She lives a life before of a very happy childhood in a socialist progressive home. Her father is an activist of the Social Democratic Party, a teacher, and she, within a very short period of time, needs to learn not only of her Jewishness, but also about being very careful with whom she can play, with whom she can speak. And very quickly also her father goes into hiding, and in the end her father will escape to England. She and her mother survives in hiding, helped by colleagues and friends from the times of her parents' political activism. But we probably won't have time to go into it, just a few pictures of Inge and her mother. Now, back to Klemperer, towards the end of March, he notices also increasing propaganda against what the Nazi propaganda describes as atrocity propaganda. And it's one of the very interesting features of presenting always the attacker as one that is defending himself. So supposedly after Hitler's rise to power, World Jewry is organizing itself against Hitler, spreading lies about him. And so in the self-defense, and in order to teach German Jews a lesson not to participate in this unpatriotic propaganda against Hitler, a boycott is being announced. And again, just a day before, Klemperer writes about meeting with his Jewish, intellectual Jewish friends, and that sense of somehow being in a place that he doesn't recognize, right? Suddenly they are in Tsarist Russia. That's not a compliment, or in the Middle Ages. This is new Germany. This is something that he can hardly recognize, and feels, as he puts it, he feels shame for Germany because he also has always felt so profoundly German, so profoundly connected with that country. And he continues to note in his diary interesting scenes. This is when he still can go to a cinema, and describes how people, simple Germans, seem to respond to that propaganda, and how it's full of contradictions, not yet completely openly embraced. The boycott affects thousands of Jewish families. We all know those images, I think, from Berlin. What I find interesting and wanted to point to you is not just the uniformed, intimidating SA members guarding the entrances to Jewish stores and Jewish firms, but the crowd around. It's difficult to read faces and to always interpret whether people seem to support it or not, but the element of being able to perform this violence in public with no responsibility, it is teaching people about Jewish still citizens being beyond the pale of legal protection or what's acceptable socially in terms of behavior. And those onlookers, those witnesses, passive likely completely, are, I think, important part of the picture. And they are also someone that will be described by Jews as we continue along this path. The next strike comes with the civil service law, which causes immediate firing of, again, thousands of Jews who are civil servants, which in Germany is a very broad concept. It's teachers, it's postal workers, it's physicians that work within the system of national healthcare. And so unless you fall into some special categories, you are fired. So Klemperer, who was a decorated war veteran who volunteered to fight in the First World War, as he puts it here, thank God I'm alive, the new service law leaves him out. He is a veteran, and as such, he's not yet fired. But his professional ability to function is shrinking. He notes that he can't publish anything anywhere, that he is very concerned with going to university and encounters with students. And this is something, again, that has very great reverberations throughout Jewish community, not just emotional, not just as a sense of humiliation. Here you have another example of someone who was a notary public, which is a very respectable position, and now his entire social status is taken away based on this new law, and he's simply dismissed in just a few words typed on the right. Another example is comes from Breslau, from the diary of Willy Kohn. Klemperer survived the war, protected by his wife, who refused, despite pressure, refused divorcing him. And it's because she stayed married to him that he was not deported. Willy Kohn, as you can see, is killed in November 1941 in Kaunas, having been deported with other Breslau Jews, and killed upon arrival with his wife and two young daughters. But this will come in 1941. In 1933, Kohn is a teacher in one of the most prestigious high schools, one that has one third Catholic, one third Protestant, and one third Jewish student body. As you can see, this is all boys. We're not in a realm of co-ed schools. And if you look at the door, it has the date of the picture. So it's 1931, and he's sitting comfortably in a classroom as a very popular teacher teaching there since 1919. But only 2 years, 3 years later, this is no longer a place where he can teach, be. And so for him and for his family, it becomes very, very difficult. Now, what he starts with, again, with Hitler's rise to power on this ominous day of January 30th, like many people, he fears the future. He says we're sitting in a mousetrap. But again, as he continues, he goes back and forth. He thinks of leaving for Palestine already in February 1933, but fears he would miss Germany. He doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know how to protect his children. He mentions here March 1933, before the boycott, Wertheim, a department store in Breslau, as a place which is guarded by SS, and that people are being beaten up when they come to shop there. So again, this intimidation comes before the official boycott, physical intimidation. He mentions Jews being brutally dragged out of courts, who are judges and lawyers. And this is, again, these are positions of extreme respect. So this is breaking all rules of how people are interacting, especially on that level of professional success. And here, just to give you a peek, this is Wertheim department store, a flagship of a chain of department stores founded by Georg Wertheim, with several department stores in Berlin as well. And he is also giving us an interesting insight into this success and then dramatic crisis faced by individuals. He, like Klemperer, is also married to a non-Jewish woman. He also converted to Protestantism. So he is a Jew in racist terms. He's a Jew because from the Nazi point of view, he's a Jew. He declared himself already not Jewish. And in fact, he divorces his wife in order to save the company, so that the company is not quote unquote Aryanized, but rather she, as an Aryan, as a non-Jewish German, can have it under her name. Of course, the name of the company is changed from that time to something else. And as I was mentioning before, the firing of all Jews who are civil servants, here Willy Kahn, if you note the date, it's June 33. So his school was actually trying to protect him. They did not immediately fire him. In fact, we know from his notes that he was put with older classes who his colleagues believed were less infused with Nazi propaganda, that they would treat him better. They were trying to keep him, but simply vis-a-vis the law and pressure, the new law and the pressures, they were unable. And so by the summer of 33, he's fired, and he doesn't know how he's going to manage, what is going to be his pension, how he can plan his life ahead. The changes in schools, of course, are affecting also both children and their parents. And so we have, again, the law that has a name that covers the real essence of it, the law against overcrowding of schools and universities, is in fact putting in quota on how many Jews, again, Jews defined in Nazi terms, can attend 5%, and then for incoming classes, only 1.5%. And then gradually it goes into nothing. But of course, this is a well-known picture. Of course, this is not just whether or not your child can squeeze into the quota and stay, but also what children in those schools experience, how they are victimized, brutalized by teachers and classmates. And so what happens is that the Jewish community is increasingly shifting children from public state school, which was the norm of German Jewry, really, into more and more of Jewish schools that are opening up simply to provide safe environment for Jewish children, not just to take in those that are kicked out. And also increasingly as well, well, also to provide employment for Jewish teachers who are fired, and increasingly to provide training towards immigration if that immigration turns out possible. And so a lot of children note in their memoirs, in oral testimonies, that relief when they were finally placed in Jewish school, where they simply were with other kids who suffered from the same situation. There are individual responses, but opening up of schools is part of a broader communal response, which is about unity and self-help, about perseverance, and about surviving the difficult patch. In September 1933, as you can see in this text issued by the newly established organization representing German Jews, they still believe in continued life of German Jewry in Germany, but they also mention Palestine. And that notion of supporting emigration while helping Jews who lost their jobs, who lost their position, who have had to move because smaller towns are becoming increasingly dangerous, you are much more exposed to violence if you are the only Jewish family or one of very few Jewish families. And so Rabbi Beck and member of his of the organization's board, Otto Hirsch, these are some of the faces of Jewish communal responses, but they seem to be always three steps behind. The fear that at the end of the Nazi policy is basically undoing of emancipation becomes reality in 1935 with Nuremberg laws, and basically turning Jews into guests that are at the mercy of the folk, of German citizens who are of the Aryan, quote unquote, of the Aryan blood. And we see how this is affecting everybody, even those people who had managed to, because of their service in the First World War, for example, who were excluded from some of the earlier anti-Jewish laws. Within a couple of years, it catches up with everyone. So just one example from one of the most powerful memoirs, by Maria Lovich Simon, who is a daughter of East European Jews living in Germany, in Berlin. Her mother dies in 1938, and as she writes it, we didn't want to put our Christian friends in a difficult situation, so we didn't notify them on time, because coming to a funeral of a Jew would at this point be an extremely courageous and dangerous act for non-Jewish, former really non-Jewish friends. And then she mentions that her father, who was a lawyer, even though he was a notary and a lawyer, and even though he served in the army and he was not immediately deprived of his ability to perform his profession, by 1938 loses it as well. So we are still again before Kristallnacht, as this speed of destruction of individual lives, of family lives, of family livelihoods is speeding up with Anschluss, with Germany expanding into Austria. All these rules now apply to Austrian Jews. And if we look at some of the legal provisions from 1938, we see how quickly the social, cultural, political, economic life of German Jewry is unraveling from one rule to the next. With Kristallnacht comes a moment of first extreme widespread violence. And I can see nervously that we're coming to almost the end. Let me just say a few words about Kristallnacht and then we'll open up for discussion. So what we usually think of with Kristallnacht are burning synagogues. These are the images that are primarily brought up. And this is, of course, traumatic and terrible enough for Jewish families and communities, but also stores that are being vandalized. Some of these images are better known. What I want to point your attention to is the intimacy of this violent wave. The fact that people are attacked in their homes, that people feel utterly, utterly left alone. And there are multiple testimonies of German Jews who talk about parents trying to call their non-Jewish friends. They clearly, by November 1938, still think they can and having no answer. There is a series of pictures that I'll go very quickly through from Firth, and they show a burning of a synagogue. First, the books are taken out and put on fire, etc., etc., but they also show scenes from people's homes. Terrified people woken up in the middle of the night, beaten up, roughed up, humiliated. And so this is the aspect that I think adds a whole new layer to our thinking of what German Jews go through between 1933 and 1938. Ruth Vinnick writes here about, as a child, about experience of being with her grandmother and how they are being attacked. And not only is there an attack and an allusion, I think, to sexual violence against her sister, but also the moment that she remembers the most, that after the kitchen was vandalized, one of the men urinated on all this stuff that was broken and destroyed. And again, the idea that you are coming to a home of an elderly woman and urinating in her destroyed kitchen shows you the degree of violence and a complete shift of how German Jews can see themselves in this context. So needless to say, after the shock of Kristallnacht, and with hundreds of Jewish men arrested and put into concentration camps, from which they would not be released unless their families provide proof of their eligibility for emigration, we have this aspect of emigration speeding up dramatically. So if you were to look at the Jewish emigration from Germany, the numbers jumped up precisely after Kristallnacht, but the window is very, very short. It's virtually, for German Jews, a year, year and a half, up to 2 years. And so families make impossible decisions of splitting up. And as Marian Kaplan's research shows, the decision and the ability to emigrate is extremely shaped by gender and age. Parents send their children, youngsters. Willy Kahn is able to send abroad his older daughter and his son, but the younger children stay with him and are murdered with him. people leave, but their parents remain. And so we have an overrepresentation of elderly German Jews after 1939, staying for those last stages in the snowballing destruction that Hilberg describes. So for those that remain, there are basically two possibilities, or three rather, and people that I quoted from show them very well. One is deportations from 1941. German Jews are deported to ghettos in Nazi-occupied Poland, or directly to their deaths, such as to Kaunas or to Riga, or to Theresienstadt, from which they are deported to Auschwitz. And these are still sometimes nuclear families, but you see a lot of elderly people in these deportations. Then there are Jews who are trying to pass or hide. Jalowicz is lucky to be able to survive in hiding in Berlin. Some 1,500 Jews who were under, and they were called, or they called themselves U-boats, submarines, because they submerged, was able to survive. And then there are cases like Klemperer, whose special status, primarily connected to their non-Jewish spouses, protects them long enough, and they are not deported before the war is over. But German Jewry that emerges from the Holocaust is completely changed in terms of its demographic, in terms of its religious mapping, and in terms of its relationship to Germany. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Natalia. That was a fantastic and upsetting presentation, because you really gave us a sense of how people felt and the pathos that they lived with. And there was so much to share there. I mean, this alone could be a whole course, as I think you showed. We had a couple questions that came in already, and I'd like to take this opportunity to invite other people to ask questions. So take a moment, please, and write, and we can go over a few minutes, maybe not too long, but just so that we can answer a couple of these questions. So the first question that we have is, if you could give a brief answer, if that's possible, what caused Hitler's hatred of the Jews?
Say it again, I'm sorry, because I saw a new question and I spaced out.
Sure. What caused Hitler's hatred of the Jews?
Yes, do we have a night for this question? It's a great question, and I think that and I'm not saying it pro forma, it is a question of questions, and I think that we will never fully know. What is clear from research that has been done in recent decade or so is that his anti-Semitism, his virulent anti-Semitism, goes back to very early stages of his life, that this narrative that he himself presented in Mein Kampf, in which he was completely unaware of the Jewish danger, and then his encounter with Ostjuden in Vienna made him aware of this Jews that are not easily recognized as Jews, then become his second target, right? We know now from research that was done especially by German historians, that he had been saying very anti-Semitic things in gymnasium, and certainly throughout the First World War during his service. He is influenced by a variety of anti-Semitic writers. And in fact, if you were to read Mein Kampf, and I do not want to encourage you to read it, but it is a fascinating read to see how this is a mishmash of all kinds of anti-Semitic ideas that have been fluctuating in Europe before. So in a way, He brings together political radicalism and a demonizing perspective on Jews that has been there. And I think that's important on the one hand to remember. I mean, I think that on the one hand, we need to do this balancing act. Hitler was a very important catalyst because of charisma that he had, because the kind of messianic euphoria that people felt for him. But at the same time, he didn't do it himself, but he was part of a much broader a wave. And all these people who joined him in the early 20s, who, again, we know that Goering and Hans Frank, and there were plenty of leading Nazis who were writing radically anti-Semitic things before they met Hitler. And then when they meet Hitler, he becomes this epiphany and a leader.
Well, thank you. I just want to take a moment. We have more questions, which I'm going to present to you. But I would just also like to ask the teachers who are in the audience to think about and respond in the chat how you can use this material in your classrooms. So I hope that the teachers who are participating today, if you could take a moment and respond to that question, how you could use this in your classrooms. Okay, so while they're doing that, let me share some other questions with you. Where can we get these diaries?
Strand. Okay. I think all of them, I mean, especially Klemperer, it had several editions. It shouldn't be difficult to get it. And I think that Klemperer is truly an amazing read, and allows you to live through that experience of Nazi Germany with him. And, you know, it's also wonderful to know that at the end of it, he survived. I think that we read diaries of survivors with a little bit less heavy heart. Of course, he describes the destruction.
Right, thank you. Okay, now we do have some other questions coming in here as well, and I do hope to hear from the teachers. Okay. Could you tell us, I guess, numbers or percentages of Jews emigrating from Germany before Kristallnacht and I guess then afterwards?
I can, but I don't trust my own memory with numbers. So let me just go back to the statistics that I showed you, but I was already rushing terribly. And we can look at it together for one moment. Okay, so you can see here where people go. Mm-hmm. North America is obviously, especially US, but here's a problem. There is quota in the US, there is white paper in Palestine, and the Evian conference doesn't end up with great success because nobody is really interested in accepting Jewish refugees. So people leave, and for me, the especially dramatic is that Europe emigration, because this is Anne Frank. This is Anne Frank with her father and her sister, right? Who escaped. They made it to Amsterdam, and then the Nazis caught up with them. So a lot of these people who seemingly made it really didn't, and they just ended up being deported from France, from Belgium, from Holland, etc. Not to mention Polish Jews who are kicked out in October 1938, and then a year later come under direct German occupation. The big thing to say is that before the outbreak of the war, half of German Jews emigrated. Now this seems like you know, depends how you look at it. This is 250,000 people who left Germany. To put it in perspective, if that same percentage happened to Polish Jewry, that would be 1.5 million, no, 2 million likely, 2 million Jews, right? So this is a community that on the one hand had longest time to organize that escape, but I think that the reading of the signs was the most difficult because it was at first in some ways moving not necessarily in a clear direction. And really Kristallnacht makes it very clear to most. But then there is little time left. And the German authorities that are pushing German Jews out at the same time don't make it easy for them. So it's not like, you know, the Nazis are waiting with passports for German Jews to please leave. So it's a very complex thing of what you do with family members. And you know, I've been listening to dozens of testimonies of oral interviews from the Shaw Foundation from Vienna because of my research on medical school. And vast majority of those testimonies of people who left for England or for United States, their parents stayed behind. And the interview always comes to a point when they are asked about what happened to their parents. And the sense that, you know, they were hoping that their parents will also get out, but they didn't.
Wow. No, thank you. Thank you. Let me just see if we have other questions here. It looks like there's a new message here.
Also, I meant to say it earlier, but I'm happy to share this PowerPoint with Paul as a PDF because I know that I was moving very fast through the citations. And I think that these citations from the diaries really could be read again over tea and without speeding.
Okay, thank you. All right. That would be great. Just looking through the questions here. Okay. Let me just ask you, since I didn't get any takers to respond to my question about how it would apply in classrooms. But would you mind addressing that?
Thank you. And I think that really, you guys are heroes teaching in schools. My intuition from mostly teaching on a college level, but I think it doesn't really, there isn't a difference. I think it's making it individual. I think that speaking in collective terms, the Jews or even the German Jews, makes it blurred. And when you look at a particular family with a particular story, when there is a documentation and you can see, you know, this is the case of Anne Frank. I'm beyond her literary talent. I think it's the materiality of that life, even the fact that we have her on a film, right? We have the footage of her, tiny, short, but nevertheless, she's there. And I've been rereading Mary Jalowicz's memoir recently, and it's stunning because she talks about her feelings and she talks about ambivalence towards her father, towards people who are helping her, towards sexual barter. She survives in ways, whatever helps her, right? And so she does all kinds of things that don't necessarily fit in any way an upbeat story of survival. Now, I'm not sure, in fact, that this would be the greatest read for children, even in high school, but there are accounts from kids. And I think that there was something very powerful about reading about school experiences of someone who, you know, who has a final exams while preparing to emigrate, but wondering whether all his family members will be able to leave, or someone who doesn't know that is Jewish until he's told in a very brutal way through persecution, and goes through this emotional upheaval of suddenly being socializing only with Jews, people who lose friends. I mean, I remember one of the more powerful conversations I had was with a woman who is a distinguished historian, author of numerous books, but one of the most powerful experiences for her was when her best friend, she was from a family that converted, she was a Protestant German girl in Berlin, and when Hitler comes to power, her best friend said to her, I don't want to be friends with you anymore because you're Jewish. And you know, decades later, books and honors and life, a whole life since that, she still remembers this very poignantly and powerfully and painfully. So I think that personal lives and family lives show so much.
Yeah, thank you so much. I think that was a great answer. And I think the material that you presented, I think, will be very useful. And thank you for agreeing to allow us to share your PowerPoint, which will be very, very useful, I think, for the teachers here. We have a few more questions, but we're really already beyond time. So
can you send me?
Is that okay if we can send? And let me just say to the people who ask questions, I'm not sure if we can save the chat. So I would just ask you to send to me or send to education an email with your question, and I will forward it to Professor Aleksiun, and I hope you will answer it.
I'm saving the chat.
Oh, okay, good. All right. So then you'll save the chat and you'll be able to answer them. Yes. So that's even better.
Paul has my email address, and I will be happy to be in conversation beyond our formal time.
Great. Well, thank you so much. I just want to wrap things up. I want to thank Professor Aleksiun for a wonderful and moving presentation. It was really, and I just maybe will point out to everybody that Professor Aleksiun grew up in Wrocław, which used to be Breslau, so she has a personal connection to the place and is in Germany today. But and I think you brought that up.
I will be back in New York. So hope
Good.
To see you, many of you.
Good, I hope so. I hope so
and
too.
Be well, be healthy.
I'll just say that please, those of you who have signed up, we look forward to seeing you for our next program tomorrow night with Wendy Lauer. If you haven't signed up, you can check your email and see the link to sign up. I hope you'll join us. And we have lectures, Avi Pott and Rebecca Coburn in December. Professor Aleksiun and Joanna, I'm going to send an email, not an email, I'll send you a link. We'll do a debrief after the program, if that's okay, for a couple minutes. So again, I want to thank you for a wonderful presentation. I'm looking forward to working with you in the future. And you really, for me, opened up a new perspective on German Jewry, and one with a lot of feeling. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody. Have a great afternoon. I hope to see you at future programming.